Simon & Schuster Audio presents General Ike, A Personal Reminiscence by John Eisenhower. Read by Edward Herrmann.
Author's note. Dwight D. Eisenhower, Supreme Commander, General of the Army, and 34th President of the United States, was one of the dynamic and influential men of the 20th century. As his only son to survive early childhood, I was able to observe him in different circumstances, sometimes official and sometimes intimate. Though I have previously avoided writing a book devoted solely to him, I have through the years read enough misleading material, most of it written by people who have no idea of what he was really like, that I finally decided to record my own view of him. Some of my conclusions are based on what I observed, but much stems from what I have learned in the course of my own writings. No matter how biased in his favor my slant may be, it cannot add much to the confusion that already exists. I never called my father Ike to his face. It was always Dad. Still, in this book, I'll always refer to him by his popular nickname, partly for convenience, and even more because Ike was, to all intents and purposes, his real name. That short, pithy epithet that connotes roughneck in the Old West was his. It served him well as an icebreaker in the Army. It was even more useful in politics. Eisenhower was the only president out of 43, as of this writing, to be burdened with a last name of four syllables. Can you imagine the public chanting, "We like Eisenhower?" Or even, "We like Dwight?" Ike was more than a name, it was his persona. By no stretch of the imagination is this book a comprehensive biography of Ike, nor is it even a history of the battles he fought. Instead, my essays will deal almost exclusively with Ike's relations with his associates, for the simple reason that the facets of his personality appear differently depending on the individual he was dealing with at a given time. Ike was one man when assigning a mission to General George Patton, another when interacting with Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery, and yet another when working with Prime Minister Winston Churchill. Admittedly, the structure I have chosen brings with it certain difficulties. One is the matter of chronology. More serious is the fact that various incidents in the Second World War appear in more than one chapter. To avoid dreary repetition, therefore, I have tried to avoid covering the details of a single incident in more than one place. Some overlap is unfortunately inevitable, and some incidents must be at least mentioned more than once in order for each chapter to stand on its own. Ike had two separate careers, the military and the political. In my own mind, there were really two Ikes. The military Ike faded from the picture when he returned to the United States from Frankfurt in November of 1945, ending his occupation duties in Germany. The Ike of the next quarter century was the political Ike, or at least the politico-military Ike. I have chosen to write about the military Ike, even though the consequences of his activities during the Second World War often carried over into his presidency. The main reason I have done so is that I know more about Ike's career as a soldier than I do about his career as a civilian. I'm also convinced that Ike's military career was far more important to him personally than his political life. Though I believe he was an excellent president, especially in his role as commander-in-chief, he did not worry much about what his political opponents said about him in that position. When it came to his military judgments, however, he was vociferous in defending the validity of his decisions. As he contemplated his career at the end of his life, nearly all the men he considered great came from the war days, not the political era. To me, at least, Ike's place in history will hinge far more on his days in uniform than on his days in the White House. With those limitations in mind, I have given a son's view of a great military leader, highly intelligent, strong, forceful, kind, yet as human as the rest of us. Chapter 1. Early Influences. George S. Patton, Fox Connor, and John J. Pershing. There are no great men, as we understood that expression when we were shavers. The man whose brain is so all-embracing in its grasp of events, so infallible in its logic, and so swift in formulation of perfect decisions, is only a figment of the imagination. Yet some men achieve goals for which numbers have been striving, and it is interesting to look over those who have attracted special attention in some field to try to make an estimate of their character, their abilities, and their weaknesses. Dwight D. Eisenhower. Patton. One dark night in late 1919, a lone automobile crept slowly along the few miles of unlit, two-lane blacktop road leading into Camp Meade, Maryland. In the car were two young Army officers, each grasping a Colt automatic pistol in his hand, both peering intently out in the blackness. Ike and his friend George Patton were expecting, at least hoping, to be accosted. As Ike told the story with a touch of swagger in later years, we'd been told that the road was full of highwaymen. We wanted to run into one so we could see the guy's face when he found himself looking down the barrels of two guns. They were disappointed, so they later claimed, that the highwayman never appeared. It is fortunate that the intended victim had chosen to take the evening off, because the careers of Ike and George could never have profited from this caper. They might have wound up in a good deal of trouble. Whose idea it was to go bandit hunting will never be known, but both men were bored with their lives as temporary bachelors in a camp that lacked family quarters, and they shared the emotional letdown that afflicted the whole Army following the exciting days of the First World War. This was Ike's and Patton's way of entertaining themselves. Those were the days when Patton's influence on Ike was at its peak. Patton was already a noted man in the Army. Graduated from West Point in 1909 and commissioned in the cavalry, he had received public accolades for his daring exploits as a member of General John J. Pershing's punitive expedition into Mexico in 1916. He enjoyed close personal ties with Pershing, based at least partly on Pershing's affection for Patton's comely sister, Nita. Patton made the most of that personal connection, using it to obtain a berth in Pershing's original entourage to France in June of 1917. Once in France, however, Patton had quickly perceived that the Army's fledgling tank corps promised shining personal opportunities, and he easily secured the general's blessing to leave his personal staff to join the tanks. As an energetic 30-year-old major, he quickly rose to the command of the 1st Tank Brigade, the largest United States tank unit in France. His time in battle was short. The Saint-Mihiel campaign, in which he participated, lasted only 2 days, and he suffered a wound in the leg on the first day of the Meuse-Argonne campaign in September 1918. Nevertheless, his reputation had been made. Adding to Patton's larger-than-life image in the Army was the fact that he was personally wealthy, and his wife was even wealthier. His consequent lack of need for his Army pay had exerted a considerable effect, no doubt, on his attitude. The Army was a hobby with Patton, though a mighty serious hobby. Ike had no such aura attached to his name, though he was also recognized as a promising young officer. He had been a successful organizer and trainer of troops during the First World War, and in that capacity had earned a prestigious Distinguished Service Medal for his energy, zeal, and leadership in commanding the Army's Heavy Tank Brigade at Camp Colt, Pennsylvania. But though DSMs were extremely rare among young officers, Ike was only 3 years out of West Point at the time, Ike's accomplishments were performed in the United States. Nothing achieved in stateside training could compete in prestige with a few days of combat service in France. Nevertheless, despite the disparity between Ike's and Patton's positions in the Army Club, Ike was far from intimidated by Patton's éclat. Ike's admiration was based strictly on Patton's generous nature and soldierly qualities, and Patton, on his part, recognized leadership qualities in an officer 6 years his junior. In his effusive way, he predicted a future war in which Ike would be the Robert E. Lee and Patton would be Ike's Stonewall Jackson. Eventually, Patton's prediction would prove at least partially correct. Ike would be Patton's superior and have to use every bit of diplomacy in his makeup to keep Patton performing his role as a combat leader. On duty, Patton and Ike were officially co-equals, both commanders of tank brigades under the chief of the tank corps, Brigadier General Samuel Rockenbach. The entire tank strength of the Army consisted of those two brigades, one light and one heavy. Colonel Patton commanded the brigade of light tanks, equipped with the small French Renault tanks, and Lieutenant Colonel Eisenhower commanded the heavy brigade, equipped with the American-built Mark 8 Liberties, designed as support for infantry. Though the two brigades were organized for different missions, all the tankers considered themselves to be members of one family, and they soon established an informal school that prevailed on Patton and others to share their wartime experiences in a series of lectures. Many members of the group contributed, and Ike, as a brigade commander, was one. He later recalled with pride that Patton habitually attended his lectures, taking extensive notes. Together, Ike and Patton set out to develop a doctrine for the future use of the tank in warfare, which they believed had not been sufficiently exploited in the recent conflict. Running parallel with such thinkers as the British J.F.C. Fuller and the German Heinz Guderian, they jointly concluded that the tank had a role in the wars of the future that transcended its traditional mission of supporting the infantry, no matter how vital that was. They visualized armored formations operating independently, attacking in masses and breaking through an enemy's line and tearing up his rear. In the blush of their enthusiasm, both Patton and Ike wrote articles for the infantry journal supporting their ideas. Eisenhower's article was radical for an infantryman. It called for a new tank armed with a 6-pounder main gun as well as its standard machine guns. To replace the clumsy, inefficient machines of Saint-Mihiel and the Meuse-Argonne, he advocated a speedy, reliable, and efficient engine of destruction. In the future, he went on, tanks will be called upon to use their ability of swift movement and great firepower against the flanks of attacking forces. Prescient though Ike's article may have been, it was not admired by certain authorities in Washington. Notable among those authorities was the chief of infantry, who was highly displeased with Ike's advocating a role for the tank beyond that of supporting the chief's own doughboys. He called the young upstart on the carpet and threatened him with court-martial if he expressed his views further in writing. The chief of cavalry did much the same with Patton. The army soon went even further. It abolished the tank corps as an independent branch and incorporated it into the infantry. Patton requested transfer back to the cavalry, and Ike, already an infantry officer, merely accepted reassignment. George and Ike parted ways, not to serve together for another 20 years. They remained friends, but on a far more casual basis. Nevertheless, Ike remembered Patton with admiration and affection as an outstanding officer, who, despite his eccentricities, was a man who loved to fight, a valuable potential associate in the future war they all expected. My first brief exposure to Colonel Patton occurred in the early 1930s, probably about 1933. At that time, Ike was a major, assigned to duty in the War Department, and our small family lived in the Wyoming apartments, a few blocks north of the State War Navy building. One Sunday afternoon, my parents announced that the three of us were going to drive out to nearby Fort Myer, Virginia, to visit the Pattons. This was not a commonplace event, and the afternoon was memorable for an 11-year-old boy. The officers' quarters at Fort Myer are neither large nor elaborate, and Patton, as executive officer of the 3rd Cavalry Regiment, was not at the top of the priority list for housing. But in whatever quarters were assigned to the Patton family, the interior was always embellished into something spectacular. One wall of the living room was covered by a great bookshelf full of gleaming silver cups, trophies won by various members of the Patton family in the horse shows that kept the Army entertained during peacetime. During our short call, Colonel Patton occupied center stage in his glistening living room, holding forth on various subjects, always conscious of his captive and generally admiring audience. On such social occasions, he confined his colorful language to mere blasphemy, saving his earthy four-letter words for the troops. Nevertheless, the spectacle was a source of wonderment to a boy who was being raised in a strict household, a boy who had heard such words only from his friends in the schoolyard. The Pattons had 3 children. The 2 daughters, Beatrice and Ruth Ellen, were a little older than their son George and me, and they sat properly as part of the group of adults. But George, a lad of about 10, received special attention. Called into the room before the adults, he was asked a couple of leading questions, to which he responded with colorful, well-rehearsed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.